Hello everyone, Facebook Live. Thank you for joining us. Let's take a moment, just open up with a word of prayer. Dear Lord, just thank you for this opportunity to come together and meet. And just thank you for your word. And just want to pray special for upcoming convention in August. Just pray for the people coming in, pray for the conference itself. Just have your hand on that. Also just pray for Pastor Shabelli, Pastor Schaller, our leadership in Baltimore. Just pray special for them. Also pray, want to pray for just Ken and Kitty Davis. Just pray special for them. Just keep them safe. And all of our missionaries all over the world, the Ormonds I can think of right now. Pastor Sam. Just pray special for them. And just continue to bless our ministry here. And just thank you for this building, this place. It was an awesome time yesterday at the men's breakfast. And then we came over and helped out clean up a garden backyard. That was just amazing. And just thank you for that opportunity. And I just continue to bless and bless the word today. In Jesus' name, amen.
Well, good morning. Welcome to church. Stand and sing with us.
Sing for all.
turn to this side, turn to that side, and say hello. Don't be so stiff now, come on. It's good to see you guys here today.
Sweetest of loves, when my heart becomes free. we just pray that you remove distractions, remove things that will keep us from entering into your presence today, God. Just allow the presence of your people, the presence in this place, the presence of those joining us inside of the Lord, to just bring us in unity, bring us in oneness, bring us together. Will for each one of our lives,
I bow my knee.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
It's time for the offering. So let's just pray real quick. God, we just thank you for this time we gather. God, we just pray that you would just allow these words, this brief message, just to glorify you, Father. Let it not be of myself, nor let it be of man. As the things we seek in this world, but let it be the things of you, God. Just let it glorify you. Just let it purify each one of us. And just allow us to be just renewed in our thoughts, our minds, our spirits today, Father. We just praise you and thank you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
I know it's not necessary, but you know what? I'm just going to ask for a little bit of grace today because, in case you didn't notice, yeah, we're a little bit out of sorts because we're missing some key players today, but you know what? We're here for one reason, and that's to praise and glorify God. And even in our weakness, even in our frailties, even in our mistakes, you know what? He is gracious, merciful to forgive us. Like his word says, he knows our hearts. And as long as we're seeking after him, as long as we're following after him, when we fall, when we fail, when we stumble, he'll pick us up. And hopefully, and that's just the thing, you know, he'll be glorified in it because it's not about us.
It's not about what we do. It's not about our striving and our shortcomings, even our gifts, because they're from Him. So we thank God for just His life within each one of us. And just speaking about that, I had a thought. The thought I had, actually thought about this, I think, a couple weeks ago, because I was unsure. You know, God tells us to live a prepared life. So I actually prepared a message a couple weeks ago because I wasn't sure if anybody's going to be here to do offering. So I thought, well, it'd probably be good to have something just in case. But just the messages that we've been receiving recently have just been amazing. And it's just, that's what the Word of God does. And that's what's so amazing when you study and you start thinking about things. It's like the Spirit brings these things, these thoughts back to you. And it's just how we, it's like that study to show thyself approved. It's like, you know, we know that these words we're receiving, these thoughts we're receiving, are for each one of us. And they can be used in our daily lives. And as we learn, as we hear more, it's just that greater understanding of what God's trying to teach each one of us through His Word. And how it just keeps building, it just keeps building, line upon line, precept upon precept. But the thought I had recently, I mean, it's basically, you know, with everything that's going on in this world, is uncertainty. Because you keep hearing this statement, I mean, on the news, on the media, and even if you're watching like in a Christian broadcast on radio, it's like, we are living in uncertain times. It's like, what are you certain about? In these times, what are we certain about? I mean, are we certain that this epidemic's ever gonna go away? Are we certain that we're gonna rise above it? Are we certain that, you know, what talk now is like, you know, they want a vaccination for it, so basically to eliminate it. But we have no certainty in that. There's no certainty even day to day. We listen to the media, we listen to the doctors, we listen to the government, we listen to our elected officials, and their word, their thoughts, their instructions change daily for each one of us. It's like, do this, no, don't do that. Let's try this, no, don't do that. But we have a certainty. We have a certainty, and that's why we're right here. We have a certainty in this book. We have a certainty in the Word of God. We have a certainty in our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. You know what? And that's what we have to be seeking after. That's what we have to be. It's just amazing that, like I say, the messages pastor's been speaking. It's like men and everybody in this world, you know, are trying to come up with a fix for what's going on in this world. And there's one fix for it. It's called Jesus Christ. And the love of God that is poured in each one of us through His Spirit when we receive Him. And the certain thing is, too, that, you know, He hasn't called us to go out and fix people in this world. He hasn't called us to fix situations in this world. Jesus Christ didn't come to fix men. He came to save their souls. And that is for one certain thing. Then when we pass away, whether it's from this virus, whether it's from something else in this world, whether it's from, you know, our own mistakes, things we choose, we have a certainty that it's not the end. It's just the beginning. That we will be with Him in heaven. Because His Word says that. His Word tells us that. But I always think about, I had a boss, he actually retired a couple years ago. And I mean, he was an awesome man. I loved him. But I didn't always agree with him. Just as everything that goes on in this world, that's the problem. You know, Pastor spoke of this. How can we fix these things in the world if we're not all focused and certain on one thing? You have to have something common that you're seeking, that you're searching, that you're basing your life on. And if you don't have that same thing, which is this Word of God, then nothing's ever going to change. Nothing's ever going to be certain. We got people running around in fear, in turmoil, in confusion, because they don't know what to believe. They don't know what to think. Most people nowadays aren't taught to think for themselves. We have a bunch of people thinking based on what the media is saying, based on what our government's telling them, based on what the doctors are saying, based on, you know, based on their own assumptions, their own, what Pastor spoke of, their own stigmas in their minds. And this uncertainty that creates fear, that creates doubt, that creates turmoil in our lives. And we need this certainty. We need this certainty in our lives. I mean, think about this, and I'll just share a couple verses with you. Think about the word certain and what certain means. Free from doubt or reservation, confident and sure. We're not living in times of uncertainty. The times have always been uncertain. I mean, what happened to Jesus Christ when he came into this world? He came to his own, and his own did not know him. Some of his own that professed to know him walked away and knew him no more. What are you certain of? Destined, sure to happen. I know a lot of people at work that know me are bringing up revelations. The Bible says this is going to happen. It's getting to the end times. The Bible says it. It's certain. Everything the Bible has said, does say, has ever said, has come true. And it's going to happen. Inevitable, bound to come. Word of God says Christ is coming back. Are we certain of that? Is that where we place our faith and our hope and our trust in Jesus Christ? Established as true or sure, unquestionable, indisputable. I heard a statement the other day. I don't even remember what it was on. It was basically someone quoted a pastor that said, I would rather defend, I don't know exactly how he said it, word for it. It was basically, he said, I'd rather defend the strength of a lion than defend the word of God. People can see a lion. It's like a caged lion. You leave him loose. He doesn't need me to defend him because he's going to rip you apart. He's going to cause turmoil. But can people see the truth and understand the word of God? God doesn't place us here to defend him. God doesn't place us here to reveal certainty of the word to people, because we don't have to defend God. God's word defends himself. God's word makes everything about God certain and sure. Fixed, agreed upon, and settled. And that's where we have to be as a people. Fixed, agreed upon, and settled on God's word. If we want to amount to anything, if we want to do anything in this world. Definite or particular, but not named or definite or particular, but not named or specific. I didn't write down any specific verses, but I actually looked up the word certain in the Bible, and especially in the New Testament. And especially with Jesus speaking, that's where the word certain defines a lot of times. A certain man, a certain woman, a certain prophet, a certain Pharisee. It's certain, it's sure. He spoke of it, he said it. And we can be confident in the truth of it. That may be dependent on, trustworthy, unfailing, and reliable. We can trust in this word. Let me share a daily devotional from Oswald Chambers to you. The graciousness of uncertainty. It doth not yet appear what we shall be. What we shall be in this world is not certain. You know, based on our health, based on our minds, based on our relationship with God, based on our jobs, based on our positions, based on our experiences, just that we've been hearing, how our experiences, how our past, how our wounds and sores affect us, it's all uncertain. But God can make it sure. God can make it certain. Naturally, we are inclined to be so mathematical and calculating that we look upon uncertainty as a bad thing. We imagine that we have to reach some end, but that is not the nature of spiritual life. The nature of spiritual life is that we are certain in our uncertainty. Consequently, we do not have our nest anywhere. Common sense says, well, supposing I were in that condition. We cannot suppose ourselves in any condition that we have not been in or experienced. Certainty is the mark of the common sense life. Gracious uncertainty is the mark of the spiritual life. To be certain of God means that we are uncertain in all our ways. We've seen it at this time. People that are certain of God are uncertain in their ways. So I'm not running around trying to explain how I can deal with this virus. I'm not running around trying to explain how this virus is going to be fixed. I'm not running around trying to explain how you protect yourself from it. I'm just trusting God. To be certain of God, I read this, but I'll repeat it again. To be certain of God means that we are uncertain in all ways. We do not know what a day may bring forth. That is generally said with a sigh of sadness. It should be rather an expression of breathless expectation. We are uncertain of the next step, but we are certain of God. Immediately we abandon to God and do the duty that lies nearest. He packs our life with surprises all the time. Does anybody like surprises? I thought about that. I mean, you think about, like, as you get older, we don't even like to think about it, but birthdays, you know. Have you ever had a birthday or especially some type of celebration you thought, well, it's just like this year. You know, you think about the kids that have graduated and their expectation of what was going to happen, basically taking a step into the next season of their lives. And basically you can think, you know, well, it's not going to happen. We're not going to get anything. There's not going to be a celebration. But think about that, the surprise when something happens. And that's how we, just like this is stating how we look at the things of God. We're uncertain. We go forward in faith. And when he does the work through each one of us, you know, it's a realization of the reality of who he is in each one of our lives. And the surprise that is given to each one of us when we just walk in faith. When we become advocates of a creed, something dies. We do not believe in God. We only believe our belief about him. Jesus said, except ye become as little children, spiritual life is the life of a child. You are never uncertain of God, but uncertain of what he is going to do next. If we are only certain of our beliefs, we get dignified and severe and have the band of finality about our views. But when we are rightly related to God, life is full of spontaneous, joyful uncertainty and expectancy. I just share a couple verses with you. The Word of God says in John 13:35, by this shall all men know that you are my disciples, if ye all have love one to another. I can try to work, I can try to do things for people, but the love of God is certain. When the love of God pours out of you towards somebody, through the Spirit, they know it, they recognize it, and it's certain. 2 Peter 3:10, but the day of the Lord will come as a thief in the night, in the which the heavens shall pass away with a great noise, and the elements shall melt with fervent heat, the earth also and the works that are therein shall be burned up. Are you certain? Because the things that's going on in this world is certain that we're in. We're heading to that, right? It's certain. The Word says it. It's going to happen. Proverbs 14:16, a wise man feareth and departeth from evil, but a fool rageth and is confident. A I'd rather be a fool for God than a fool in the confidence of this world. Because the confidence in this world is only leading to death. Philippians 1:6. Being confident in this very thing, that he which hath begun a good work in you will perform it until the day of Jesus Christ. And just closing thought to the for the offering. If I can find out where I wrote it here. Giving in uncertainty. We give of ourselves. We give of our tithes and our offering in uncertainty. We thank God and we praise God for the blessings that he bestows on us. But when we're faithful, we can be certain that he'll bless us in our giving. He calls us to give back what he has blessed us with. We don't know what a day will bring, but we can be certain that he will be glorified in our givings. Let's pray. Father, we just thank you for this time, God. And I just pray that you would just bless each one today. Just bless their hearts, their minds, their souls. And just allow their certainty in everything in our lives to be rooted and grounded in our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Because we don't know what day may bring. We don't even know, number one, if I'll be here tomorrow. But based on what the Word of God says, I don't even know if this world will be here tomorrow. But because we have a certainty in our faith, we have a certainty in what our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ did for us, we are certain that no matter what happens, his Word says that he has gone to prepare a place for us. We can be certain of that. God, we just thank you for your Word. We just thank you for your people. We just pray that you would just continue to raise us up, to use us for your glory, Father. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Thank you. Have you ever approached something with a certain level of inadequacy? And then you hear a song like that, and you consider the faithfulness of God. And that His promise still stands. And that is our confidence. That becomes our confidence. It's good to see you here today. Thank you so much for coming out. We have some great friends of ours, friends of the ministry as well, for years now. And Johnny was with us in Africa. How many years ago, Johnny? Quite a few. Four or five or six, somewhere in that range. That's kind of how my memory works too, Johnny. Four, five, or six is somewhere in there, right? I think Johnny and Colton had a special bonding in that trip, didn't you guys? Yeah, I think so. And it's great to have his son Brandon here today, and I'm going to ask him to come up and just share just for a quick minute about what's going on in his life. He's graduated from the Bible College in Baltimore, and he has some exciting news of what's going on. So come on up real quick, Brandon, if you would.
Miracle. So she's a true miracle, thank God for her. So just this morning, like, he asked, like, you know, do you want to speak? You know, do you want to say something? And at first I'm like, you know, no. Because I don't like getting up front at all. But just with this morning and the way everything's been going this morning and the songs and, you know, just, you know, great is His faithfulness. And I thought about just all this time, I mean, these guys, Pastor John, Colton, and Dakota, and many of you here, you know, were there the first day at the Bauermaster's picnic years ago when I heard about Bible College and Church of Greater Grace. And I was already going to a church already, but I wanted more. And I just went down for a visit, and God really called me out of the book of Haggai, and it says, it's chapter 1, verses 5 through 9, where it says, you eat but you do not have your fill, you drink but you do not have your fill. And I want you to sell, like, I want you to go to the hill country, grab your lumber, and come and rebuild my kingdom. So as I read that, I live in the mountains, so there's my wood, right? So, but it just, like, spoke to me, and the Holy Spirit just was, like, relaying that to me. Just, you know, pack everything that you have, and I want you to come to Bible College. And I did not know, I had no friends, I had no family, I had no place to stay, and I had no job. But I had God, right? So God, thank God. You know? So I knew, like, by just going by faith, that God was going to just put everything together, put the pieces together. Right now, the puzzle pieces are all scattered all over the floor, but each piece He puts together, and out of each piece is something that's beautiful. It's not only for myself to see, it's for you guys to see, yeah. And, you know, and just, God's just been faithful in that. And I thought, I was just thinking of this, and, you know, I had to do my research on my iPhone. I kind of cheated a little bit. So I just thought of Matthew chapter 13 and 44 and 45, when it says, again, the kingdom of heaven is like unto treasure hidden in a field, the which, when a man hath found, he hideth, and for joy thereof goeth and selleth all that he hath, and buyeth that field. And again, the kingdom of heaven is like unto a merchant man seeking goodly pearls. So there was something there. Whenever I went to the Greater Grace in Baltimore and to check out the Bible College, there was a treasure there. And I came back and just told my parents, like, hey, I'm going to, you know, I'm going to go to Baltimore. I'm going to move. I'm like, oh, you know, when are you gonna move? You know, yeah, bye. But I like told them, and they said, well, when are you gonna go? And I said, tomorrow, like right the next day. It was a bold move, you know, that I came home, told them. That night I packed everything I had, and the next day the moving van was there. Because when God calls, we all have a calling on our life. So there's like no hesitation in that, like just go. I didn't see anything, like the unseen. You know, I could sit down, I could have been like, well, I ain't got the money, I don't have a job, I don't have a car, I'm leaving my cat. I don't know what I'm gonna do. But in the unseen, like that's God. God's gonna show us that. And you said about the surprises, I love surprises. Way back when, for some of you that might be here, we had Bonanza, or no, Ponderosa, the old little diner, and they brought this purple bag out for kids. And in that purple bag, you always got to go in and you pulled a surprise out. So with God, it's like, that's that for me. Like, that's how I always kind of explain it, because I'm just in like, my hand's in the bag, and I just know, like, whatever I pull out is gonna be beautiful. That's what God has for me. So, just for prayer for us, we have, we're getting married in October, and we are going to, once again, take the leap of faith, and we're going to move to Texas and join the Evergrace team with Pastor Chris Moore and another Greater Grace church down there. God did it once before, and he'll continue to do it again as we go by faith. So thank you as a church. Just be praying for us.
Okay, will you stand with me? We had a great time yesterday at the men's breakfast and on outreach, and God is a good father, isn't he?
Yes.
So happy Father's Day to all our fathers, and all actually to all our men, because if you're not a father, you're a father to somebody's kid, trust me. Right? We all end up fathers at some point. So Father, we do just ask, Lord, that you bless our message today, that you use it in our lives, in Jesus' name, amen. You can be seated. 1 Corinthians 14:40 says we should do things decently and in order. And God has a perfect order in Deuteronomy chapter 32, verse 4, and in Psalm 18:30. And there's a certain authority in an inward order. So we talked about on Thursday night and on Monday in our Bible study how there is an outward order, like you have a certain outward order maybe in your home. Like the silverware goes in where? The silverware drawer, right? So there's a certain order in your home, there's a certain outward order, but there's also an inward order. And we have this inward order, and there's an authority in this inward order that demands a blessing and a certain protection. And in 1 John 2, we see this incredible order that God puts in place for us. As God the Father is the planner, Jesus Christ the Son executes the plan, and the Holy Spirit is the revealer and the minister of the plan. Now, plan here is to show the form of. So God has a plan, and this plan is to show the form of. Is to represent an intended work. Is to form something that is expressed in words. It made me think of, I have a part of my job at work is part of working with the building department. And so we have a responsibility where we take a set of architectural plans and we help do the equipment planning for the plans. They're planning a new radiology department, so we have to buy the x-ray machines. So we work with the architects. So you look at this set of architectural plans, right? And it's just a plan. You can't see the building. You can't see what's going to happen to the building. You don't know what's exactly going to go on, but you can see the plan. You can see where the door is going to go. You can see where the rooms are. You can see these things, but it's just a plan, right? And it's a form of it, but it's not the actual thing. We don't see the building yet, right? So it's a plan. Then we have the Son who executes the plan. In the Latin, ex sequor, S-E-Q-O-U-R, which means to follow, to follow. It's a transitive verb, and it means to follow through, to perform, to complete, to finish. Think of Jesus Christ as executing the plan, performing it, completing it, finishing it. And he's performing what is required to give it validity. It means to support, and it becomes efficacious in meaning that it has an effect. So there's the execution of the plan. So the architect has the drawings. Now the builder does what? He takes the drawings and he builds what the planner has planned, right? So the planner has a plan. He has made the plan. Now the builder is going to take the plan and he's going to build the building. And you can watch the building start to go up. It's amazing. We watched the Waynesboro Medical Office building go up after we had worked on this building, and it was amazing to watch the steel start to go up, right? The framework of the building. The foundations pour, then they start to put the building up. And you watch the building start to go up, and you see the plan being executed. Mm. And then you go into the building as it's being built, and you go in and you say, well, that door really isn't where I want it. I want it over here. And so then you make a change. A change is made to the plan to correct something that's not quite right, and we change it. And it's because you're now starting to, as the plan's becoming executed, you're starting to see how the plan is coming together, right? And then the plan, eventually, the building is getting done, right? And then we have the Holy Spirit, who is the revealer, which is R-E-V-E-L-O in the Latin, revelo, which means to unveil, or to disclose or show, or to make it known. And this is the time where we had the plan, and then we had the builder build the building, and now we all stand at the front door, and somebody cuts the ribbon, and we all walk through into the building, right? And it's done, and it's revealed to us. And we can walk through the building, and we can see where everything is based upon the plan that was drawn. And it's all revealed to us. And we can now see it, and it comes to fruition. God sets the framework for our life. Jesus Christ performs the work necessary. And the Holy Spirit reveals to us as we walk with him. In Jeremiah 50:20, the Father doesn't see our sin. He does not see your sin. And in Hebrews 10:17, the Son does not see our sin because we are part of his body, part of his flesh, part of his bone. We are of the same spirit in 1 Corinthians 6:17. So he cannot see our sin. So God doesn't see our sin. The Son doesn't see our sin. But what about the Holy Spirit? Does the Holy Spirit see our sin? Well, it says that the Holy Spirit is grieved and quenched. So yes, he does see our sin in 1 Thessalonians 5:19 and Ephesians 4:30. So the plan can be a great plan and it can be executed fully, but it can't be revealed or ministered to us when we live in sin. It's almost like we can build the building, right? We can have the plan and we can build the building, but if the building that was built for something gets changed or gets used for something that it wasn't made to be used for, then the building itself can't function in the way that the planner planned for it to be used and the executor executed the plan. Do you understand what I'm saying? God has a plan for our lives, does he not? Did Jesus Christ not execute the plan to make a way for us to live in that plan by grace and love and mercy and by dying on a cross? He did, absolutely. But this is why a believer who is eternally secure can live in insecurity. They are driven by emotions. They live in a temporal thinking and natural thoughts, which are passing away, so they don't find a purpose in life. They don't find a purpose for the building. God says, I gave you the plan. I've made the way. Here is the building. But they don't find a purpose in the building. There's a purpose in our building. There's a purpose in your building. Matthew 12:25 says, a kingdom divided cannot stand. We can't separate the planner from the executor, from the revealer. All three work together. Think of the plan of creation of man. He gave you a body, did he not? Everybody have a body? I guess so, or you wouldn't be here, right? Do you have a soul? Well, I guess so, or you wouldn't be here. Do you have a spirit? Yes, you do. So you have a body, you have a soul, you have a spirit. Those three cannot be separated. Until, of course, the time you go home to be with Christ. We each operate individually in God's plan. God has a purpose in you as an individual in his plan for our life. As we allow it to have authority in our lives, as we allow to have the inward order have authority in our lives, he brings in a protection and a blessing. And Satan will be removed from a position in the circumstances of our lives and our thinking when we operate under that authority. When we operate in that inward order, he can't have place because there will be no division. In 1 John 3:8, the Word of God says that where there is a manifestation of Christ, he destroys the works of the devil. You want to destroy the works of the devil in your thinking, in your choices, in the things that you do, manifest Christ. And how do we do that? Die. Think of kingdom authority and how we can disarm the world system by three words like, I love you, or I forgive you. We can have authority through prayer. We can have authority in unity. Bill said yesterday we were at breakfast, he reached over to me and he said at during our men's breakfast yesterday, he said, you know, we have not one regret in the decision we made to sell the building to you guys. There's a beautiful unity in that thought. That God would be glorified. Not us, right? Not anyone else, but that God would be glorified in it. And there's a protection and a blessing in that. When we come out from under the authority, we come out from under the plan. It doesn't change what Christ did, does it? No. He still died on the cross. In Ephesians 5:18, we have this mandate from God. And it says, be filled with the Spirit. Be filled with the Spirit. Pastor Schauer said the other day on Grace Hour that the teaching and function of the Holy Spirit for the practicality of life is of immense importance. When we wake every morning, we should say, Holy Spirit, come into my life and fill me. Because we want the plan and the executor of the plan and the revealer of the plan to be one in us. And it will demand an authority, a protection, and a blessing. Think for a second with me of someone's reaction to something or someone recently. Think back to something that's happened in your life just recently, to someone's reaction to something you said or did. Think of it just for a second. Everybody got something? Okay, now, think for a second, was that reaction from a person filled with the Holy Spirit operating in them, ministering and revealing who God is and what Christ did? Think about it. Yesterday's portions in the body were revealed in our outreach. It was beautiful. And we might not have seen it. And you might not have been able to be there. And there's no condemnation. But they were revealed in an incredible way. We watched the body minister to the young and the old. It was amazing to see Kelly Showers talking with the little girl and having her read a book to you. Yeah. That portion was beautiful. And the mom saying to us, we have never seen an outpouring of the love of God in this way. We've never seen it. This is the hands and feet of Christ working in my life. And we reciprocated that love in our words and actions. And maybe you couldn't be there, but you loved from afar. You prayed with us and for us, and your heart and mind was with us. And that is what we're speaking about as we walk in oneness. We walk in togetherness. And there's a certain unity in the plan, in the execution of the plan, and that being revealed to people's hearts. See, people had a spirit-filled reaction to the call. And some people probably weren't really happy about going. But that's okay too. Because God had a plan and a purpose in even that. And sometimes we have to let the first Adam come so that he can pass, so that we can walk in the Spirit of God. And this produced an incredible blessing, not only in them, but in us. See, God has a plan in salvation. And Dave said yesterday, he said, you know, there's a certain simplicity in the Word of God. Like, we don't have to go into all this stuff. Like, he gave one verse, and we contemplated it for a few moments yesterday at breakfast, and it was beautiful. God's plan of salvation is pretty simple. Will you receive and believe me as your Lord and Savior? The depravity of man in Romans 5:12 and Jeremiah 17:9 is no match for God's plan in Isaiah 53:3-5, Romans 6:14, and Romans 8:28-30. But there is sometimes pain in the plan. There is sometimes separation in the plan. There is sometimes death in the plan. And this is why only a sinless Christ could execute that plan. See, he had to go through the pain. He had to be separated from the Father. He had to die. He had to be buried. But then what happened? The better part of the story, right? He rose again. And it's beautiful, and that's the plan of salvation. Think about Paul in Acts chapter 27. God shows him his plan is that you're going to be shipwrecked. That's interesting. Be like God telling me, on your way to church today, you're going to be in a car accident. Well, okay. And that's part of your plan, right? Right? But God had a plan in the shipwreck. And the Son executed the plan. And the Holy Spirit revealed it. And Paul's response was simple. I will believe God. Well, I believe God. Will you believe God for the plan he has for your life? Pastor Vieter said, it's not about knowing the plan or understanding the plan, but it's about being occupied with your provision for the plan. See the fellowship of the mystery. Receive the manifold wisdom of God through it. Represent what the kingdom authority covering and governing our life means. Have God's sovereignty made clear to us. Have you ever looked back and say, I get it now? I get it. Brandon did. He just told you, didn't he? He just told you, right? I love too, Trina, how he said, I came home, I packed everything up, and he was worried about the cat. Didn't say anything about you, but he worried about the cat. But listen, God had a plan in his life, and it all started with a picnic. Now the battle masters can say, what's the big deal about a picnic? But the picnic is where Brandon met the church. He ended up in Bible college. He graduated Bible college, and now he's going to Houston, Texas to minister to people, and it all started with a picnic. Did God have a plan? Yeah. He had a plan, and he has a plan for your life. And sometimes the plan isn't for us to understand. And sometimes we don't see it. And sometimes we're in the pain and the separation and the death. And we don't see the end from the beginning. But God does. And he knows it. Wow. In Acts 26:16, Jesus said to Saul, I have appeared to thee to make thee a minister and a witness. Showing a guy who was a persecutor of Christians that he had a plan and purpose for his life. Listen, in Joshua chapter 7, and we'll close. Achan, his wife, and their family were cursed, stoned, and burned because he coveted and took something that God told him not to take. The family tent was burned, their belongings were burned, their animals were burned, they were burned. Everything about them was cursed and burned. Then it was all covered up by a heap of stones. And it is called the Valley of Achor. And it was cursed because of what Achan had done. So what could come out of that? What could come out of that? In Hosea 2:15, God said, I will take the Valley of Achor and turn it into a door of hope. Your life just might be the door of hope for somebody else today. Your life could be the door of hope. In 1 John 3:1, behold what manner, what quality of love the Father has bestowed, has imparted with the purpose, that he then has the ability to call you and I sons and daughters of God. You are a son and a daughter of God. Behold in here speaks of an obligation. God could never withdraw his love because of what Christ has done. So no matter what's going on in the plan of God, in your life and my life, remember we can be certain of this. That God has an unmatched, unfathomable, eternal love for you right in the midst of it. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Father, we just thank you, Lord, for the word of God, for this service time we've had here today, Lord, for the time that we've had to just think with you, to think about your plan, the execution of the plan, and how the Holy Spirit that you've given us to reveal and minister that plan to us, Lord. Father, you're using our lives today. And in that plan, Lord, there is a plan of salvation, as we said. And this plan comes from simply receiving and believing Jesus Christ who has paid the penalty for your sin. And it's simply in your heart that you just say that, look, I'm a sinner and I need Christ. It's that simple. And Christ comes into your heart. He gives you the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit will begin to reveal that plan of salvation and what God has truly done for you in your life. And he will minister to you and he will love you just as you are, just where you're at. Receive him today. And we just thank you for this time, Lord. Bless the remainder of it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. everyone stand. Let's sing our last song.
So much for being here. Just a reminder, Tuesday night, 7 p.m. Facebook Live, we'll have a Bible study. And then next Sunday, Pastor Shabelli will be here from our church in Baltimore. He's our director of missions. He'll be here preaching, and we'll be having a wrap immediately following. So you're welcome to be here and join us for that. And then something to mark on your calendars, July 25th and 26th. Do I have the dates right?
Yeah.
At the Stutzman's home on Saturday the 25th, we'll be having a volleyball tournament. It's just a really good time. It's very relaxed. You're welcome to come. Even if you don't play volleyball, come and hang out. They have a pool, beautiful home up there that they open for us, and they allow us to come. And then service will be there on the 26th, along with a wrap there. So you'll want to put that in your calendar. And then our international convention in Baltimore, Maryland, runs from August 3rd through the 8th. This is where all of our missionaries come in from overseas. They all come into Baltimore. They do services. There's food booths set up. It's an amazing time. If you can make it down there for even a day, a night, a service, whatever, it's a great time down there. So we're looking forward to that. Again, that's August 3rd through 8th. And we did hear that registration is free this year. So hey, that's even better yet, right? How can you beat free? Right? So looking forward to that, and we will be down there all week. We're planning on being down there all week for convention. Anybody have any prayer requests today before we close? Prayer requests? Wrap. So wrap is after service when we have a meal, and then So we do this regular service, and then we stay after, we have a meal, and then when people are able to share, ask questions about the messages, it's really just a relaxed time where we spend some time together as a body in fellowship. Yeah. Any prayer requests? Hookers? And that's Dawn and Shannon. And then also for Bill and Nikki, who just got back from the hospital, keep him in your prayers.
Becky and Shane and the new baby.
Becky and Shane and the new baby.
Nursing home, my mom.
Kelly's mom, Bobby's dad.
Nursing home.
Brandon and Miracle for their move.
Aunt Ruthie.
For our youth. You know, God has a plan, doesn't he? Amazing. Father, we just ask, Lord, that each of these requests that have been made known today, Lord, and the ones that are in our hearts that weren't made known, Lord, that we bring them boldly to your throne of grace, that we trust you for your plan, that we are thankful for your Son, and we are so grateful for the Holy Spirit who reveals and ministers to us through your word, Lord. And we just ask, Father, that you bless each one as they go. We thank you for their lives. In Jesus' holy name, amen.
Amen.